listening to the Paul McGuire Report. My name is Paul McGuire, and on today's program, we're going to talk about some intense stuff, very important stuff, and that is the global cult, satanic Illuminati revival, if you will. A revival of the supernatural, a revival of principalities and powers that were once hidden or behind the scenes, becoming increasingly out in the open, and a radical transformation of our societies by an occult, a hidden occult elite that operate through secret societies, satanic groups, witchcraft groups, and others, as the Bible predicted would happen in the last days. So it's important for you to listen to today's program of the Paul McGuire Report and to pass this program on around to your friends that desperately need to hear this information. Now, you can send them the link by simply going to paulmcguire.us, paulmcguire.us. McGuire is McGuire. Or we're broadcasting on Blog Talk Radio, the Paul McGuire Report on Blog Talk Radio, but you can link to it very easily by going to paulmcguire.us. And also we have the show posted for you on YouTube. And you can also listen to previous programs, as well as send them out, as well as hear the program any time of day at your convenience. So this is the Paul McGuire Report. Today's program is very, very important. I want to begin with a scripture verse, which you are going to hear me read a lot, because it's from the words of the Apostle Paul, and it's probably one of the most important scripture verses that I live by, and I want to read it as an ever-present reminder for you and for me. Paul says in Ephesians chapter 6, starting at verse 10, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, taking up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand, therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints." Now, this is so critical because we live in an age where there are many, many Christians, despite the fact that the supernatural is exploding all around us, despite the fact that the fastest growing religion in America is Wicca or witchcraft. Witchcraft is the number one fastest growing religion in America. Islam is number two. Despite the fact that Illuminati symbols, satanic symbols, the occult, witchcraft is on movies, it's on television, music videos, giant concerts in huge stadiums, performances at the halftime game of the Super Bowl and the Olympics, we're experiencing a full-blown occult revival. Despite that, in a manner that's somewhat parallel to what happened in Nazi Germany, the vast majority of the Christian church has pressed the snooze button and is snoring loudly through the most important end times battle before the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. 75% of evangelical churches don't teach Bible prophecy, and I would venture to say that 75% or more don't teach the nitty-gritty aspects of spiritual warfare from a biblical perspective. And that means God's people are vulnerable. They're soft targets for the enemy. And in the meantime, satanic groups, witches groups, New Age groups are recruiting young people and discipling them in Satanism and witchcraft and the supernatural and the occult at an all-time high, at an exponential rate. And this occult penetration, this satanic revival, is spreading to every quarter of our planet right now. I remember the Olympics being held in Great Britain not that long ago. One Illuminati satanic symbol after another. A Tower of Babel. The number 9. We could go on and on of the numerous amount of satanic symbols. Halftime Super Bowl games. Madonna, Katy Perry singing about witchcraft and occult symbolism everywhere. The same with rock music. Illuminati symbols on music videos. Movies about Satanism and the occult. The number one genre of movies that young people like. The number one thing that drives them into the theaters are what they call supernatural thrillers, which deal with the occult, so on and so forth. So we live in the last days. The last days is a time when there will be a resurgence of demonic and supernatural activity. So Paul is telling us that we are to perceive ourselves as soldiers in Christ, not militant, violent soldiers, but law-abiding, loving, peaceful soldiers who fight a spiritual battle, not a physical battle, not with guns and hurting people, a spiritual battle which consists of prayer and evangelism and stuff like that. So the first thing is we're supposed to be strong in the power of the Lord. Many Christians don't even know how to be strong in the power of the Lord. They think they just read some Bible verses. No, you're supposed to walk under the anointing of the Holy Spirit and the power of his might, and you're to wear the full armor of God. Why are you to wear the full armor of God? You're to wear the full armor of God because that's the only way you're going to stand against the devices and the schemes and the wiles of the devil. See, the Bible is teaching us that we are targets, that Satan and Lucifer and the demons are involved in a spiritual warfare against us, whether we know it or not. They're opposing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Any Christian that is attempting to live for Christ, to shine the light of Christ in this dark world, is going to be a target. Now, if you're a backslidden Christian, that is a Secret Service Christian, you're going to be left alone. But if you're doing anything at all to try to shine the light of Jesus Christ into this dark world, you're going to be involved in a spiritual battle. And then the Apostle Paul gives us an outline. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. So there's a whole organizational hierarchy of demonic powers. And Paul tells us, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, having done all to stand, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, above all taking the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts or missiles of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. So Paul is telling us that we need to have the full armor of God on, and we need to operate in this world to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, because we're in a combat with invisible beings, demonic powers. And that's the combat that the church has been in with Satan ever since Christ resurrected from the dead and sent the power of his Holy Spirit on the church. That's what Israel has been up against. That's why Israel is hated. That's why there's such an opposition to the Jews having the land of Israel, because it's a covenantal promise between God and the children of Israel. So I want on today's program to equip you. I want to give you not just information, I want to give you supernatural principles from the Word of God that will supernaturally enable you to be victorious. You know, the Bible says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, goes about like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Well, being sober means you're not drunk, you're not intoxicated with the spirit of this world. You're in your right mind, you're in your sound mind. And vigilant means you're on your guard, you're paying attention, you recognize that you're in a battle, you got your eyes open. And then it says, be sober, be vigilant, for your adversary, the devil and the demons, are going about like a roaring lion, seeking whom they may devour, which means they may not devour everybody. They can only devour the person who is asleep and not paying attention. Now, again, the fastest growing religion in America is Wicca or witchcraft. Islam is number two. There's an explosion in Satanism and recruitment in occult witchcraft, satanic religions, because we're in the last days and there's a dividing line. People are either becoming Christians, they're being saved, they're being born again, they're getting into the Word, they're walking in a supernatural relationship with Jesus Christ, or they are following and surrendering to the powers of darkness. Where does all this lead? Well, it leads to where the Bible says it will lead. When we pick up any portion of Bible prophecy that tells us this, that's why it's so important to study Bible prophecy. If you don't study Bible prophecy, you're like a guy that threw away his GPS system or his map. You're clueless. You're operating in the dark. But you see, when you read Bible prophecy, you can understand the signs of the times. You understand what's happening now, and you understand where we are going as a nation, as a world. And so let's just pick up a section of Bible prophecy, one we referred to the other day, and that's in Revelation 13. And we read in Revelation 13. Well, let's start with Revelation 12. Now, in Revelation 12, starting at verse 7, it says, and war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought. But they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. So the great dragon was cast out, the serpent of old, called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ have come, for the accuser of our brethren, who accused them before our God day and night, has been cast down. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. And they did not love their lives to death. Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down to you, having great wrath, because he knows his time is short. So what do we see here? We see that there is a great spiritual warfare that breaks out in the last days. Michael, who is one of God's highest ranking angels, fought the dragon, that's Satan, and the dragon and his angels, the fallen angels, fought. And it says, but they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. So there are one-third of the angels that are following Satan. They will be cast out to the earth. And so the warfare happens on the earth in what we call a parallel universe, or the invisible realm, or the spiritual world. We can't see it with our physical senses, but it rages all around us. And you and I, by the way, are involved in that battle. Every family that you know, every person that you know, every nation, every community is involved in this spiritual battle, whether they know it or not. And finally, it says this. It says, I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ have come. For the accuser of our brethren, that's Satan, because Satan is an accuser. Whenever you have the voice of accusation, like you're not worthy enough, or you know, you're not holy enough for God to bless you. But the accuser of our brethren, who accused them before our God day and night, has been cast down. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. So what does that mean? It means that one of the primary spiritual weapons that Satan uses is to accuse God's people day and night of not being worthy, of saying they're not holy enough, or to remind you and attempt to remind God of the sins you committed and why you don't deserve to have your prayers answered. But you see, you can destroy those works of the adversary in your life by the word of your testimony and the blood of the Lamb. What does that mean? You've been born again. That's your testimony. By receiving Jesus Christ as your Lord, you were saved by faith, just received it as a gift, not as of works. You didn't work to get salvation. You received it as a free gift by faith, and that the blood of the Lamb, that's very important, that the blood of the Lamb, you've been saved by the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony, or you overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony. What does that mean? You have the power to overcome the devil by the blood of the Lamb. It's the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses us of all sin, past, present, and future. And when we appropriate that blood by asking Jesus for forgiveness, we're cleansed of all sins by the blood of the Lamb. Now that means we then can receive the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus by faith. Our righteousness is not something based on our performance. It's based on our faith in the blood of the Lamb that cleanses us of all sin. And therefore, when God sees us, he sees us as sinless and holy, because we've been cleansed not by our works, but by the blood. And therefore, we can come boldly to the throne of grace, that means unmerited favor, to find an ever-present help in time of need. So if we're in a crisis or a challenge, or if we have problems, we can come boldly to the throne of grace to find an ever-present help of time of need. And that's how we use the blood of the Lamb to get into the throne room of God. And that's why we can win the spiritual warfare, because the devil will tempt us to sin. And then if we do sin, the devil will accuse us of sinning and saying we're not worthy to have our prayers answered and we're not worthy for God to help us, which is a lie. We are worthy because our sins can be totally forgiven and erased, so to speak, by the blood of the Lamb. So this is the essence of spiritual warfare. Now, everything that is happening in our world and in our nation has a physical component and has a spiritual component. So whether we're talking about the economic system or the social system or the spiritual system or the geopolitical system, there's the physical part of it and there's the spiritual. The same with global geopolitical affairs. There's the spiritual component and there's the physical component. So let's take for a moment economics, money, or mammon. Economics or money is the world system. It's how you get food. It's how you pay your rent or buy a house or pay a mortgage or whatever. The economic system is commerce and trading and employment and things like that. Now, who controls the world system of finances? Well, it's controlled by a Babylonian system that began in ancient Babylon. Ancient Babylon was where the world's first one world government, one world religion, and one world economic system happened. And Mystery Babylon involves the secrets, the occult secrets of that system. And one of the occult secrets of the Babylonian system is the satanic monetary system, which is built on a concept called debt slavery. Now, when you understand this, and by the way, you cannot understand Bible prophecy without understanding the money system. You cannot at all understand God's prophetic word unless you understand the money system. So you have to understand the money system, because the money system and Bible prophecy work hand in hand. That's why in ancient Babylon there was a one world government, a one world religion, and a one world economic system. And that's why when Mystery Babylon returns in Revelation 17, 18, again we see commercial Babylon, spiritual Babylon, governmental Babylon, and so forth. That's why the monetary system is spiritual. It's not purely physical. Now, most Americans and people in Europe are deceived. They walk in spiritual deception. They're deceived by the world system. It's the deception of the world system which allows them to be slaves of Satan without them knowing it. And Christians, that should know better, because theoretically they're renewing their minds with the Word of God, should not be deceived by the world system when it comes to money. They should see the truth, because Jesus Christ said, "You shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free." So here is how the God of Mammon, or the occultic world system of money, works. It works on a principle called debt slavery. Powerful secret occult societies have passed on through what is called the Illuminati bloodline families, secret knowledge on how to control people, how to control money, and how to control people through religion and money and sorcery and government. And the way it works is this: the monetary system is an occultic system. The people who own all the money, they understand that. Many of them are in the Illuminati. They're in the secret societies. They go back many generations. There's generations and generations of satanic ritual abuse and occult involvement and witchcraft and membership in secret societies like the Illuminati or the Rosicrucians and so on and so forth. It's multi-generational Satanism. And they pass the dark occult secrets on from generation to generation. Many of these people are the ruling elite families of our world. They understand how the game works. And when you see, for example, who controls the Federal Reserve? Well, the Federal Reserve is an independent international banking cartel, which is controlled by the most elite secret families in the world that control all the money. The same with the central banks of Europe. It's an elite Illuminati families, multi-generational, that control the central banks of London. Now, you can't understand the money system unless you understand the occult nature of money. This is why I wrote my new book, A Prophecy of the Future of America, 2016-2017, to open this up for people in a way that they can understand. And then most of all, not just leave you hanging there, but show you the supernatural, powerful, biblical answers where God can supernaturally prosper you in the last days. God can supernaturally multiply your wealth, meet your needs, give you supernatural guidance. because I spent a great deal of time researching the supernatural principles that were being utilized by Daniel, the prophet, and Joseph, and King Solomon. And I was amazed to see how much information there was in the Bible about an alternative system, God's system of economics, which sets people free. And it's talked about by Jesus. You know, when Jesus was having to feed the 5,000, he had, a couple of fishes, a couple of loaves of bread. And there's no way physically that that would have fed 5,000 hungry people. So how is it that God had enough resources? Well, he didn't rely on the world system, because the world system would not have been able to produce enough money. He had to rely on God's supernatural system of economics. So while the 5,000 people were gathered there, Jesus was with the disciples. He looked into heaven and he thanked God the Father for the fish and the loaves that he did have. And as he gave thanks to God for what he did have, God supernaturally multiplied what he had. And there was so much fish and so many loaves of bread that all of the people ate to their heart's content, and there was stuff left over. Now, that doesn't happen in any natural economic system. That only happens supernaturally. So I discussed this, how you can apply those principles in the nitty-gritty. Because see, unless they work in the nitty-gritty of your real life, they're useless. How you can apply those principles in the nitty-gritty of your real life in the book, A Prophecy of the Future of America, 2016-2017. And if you want to get the combined package, the four DVDs, Prophecy of the Future of America, 2016-2017. So in the beginning of these DVDs and books, I center in on the global financial system, and specifically the central banks of Europe and the Federal Reserve. And I really crack it open on a deeper level, but also it's simple enough for the average person to understand. I break it open, because there's deep truths in this. And you see, you got to understand that these are not just wealthy people. These are wealthy people that are high up in the Illuminati and the occult. In fact, many of them perform satanic worship and are involved in secret societies. Now, they control the wealth supernaturally by using satanic power. And it's a magical system. That's why Sir Arthur C. Clarke, the guy who wrote 2001, A Space Odyssey, he coined that expression, science is magic. And he wasn't just trying to be cute. He was saying, in the perspective of the elite, science is magic. And what that simply means is that the modern economic system, and by modern, I mean going back thousands of years, to the Knights of Templar and the ancient families of Europe and other ancient civilizations, Rome, Greece, Babylon, Egypt with the pharaoh, god-king, slave system. And what these people have done is they print money from nothing. And then they loan it to individuals, and they loan it to governments at interest and make astronomical profits. And it's called a debt slavery system, because by design, nations and individuals are encouraged to be in debt, because when you're in debt, you become a slave to the lender. The Bible says the debtor is the slave to the lender. And these occultic people know that. Now, when they print money from nothing, you see, that is the sorcery. That's the trickery of it. Wouldn't you like it? Wouldn't you think of it about it this way? Imagine if you could do this without being arrested. You had a color copier, or a bunch of them, and you opened an office, and you would loan people money. So somebody comes to your office and says, I want $100,000. And you say, okay, I'm going to give you $100,000 right now. Sign this out. And you check on their collateral. And then you say, but you have to pay it back at 12% interest over 30 years or whatever. And then you go into another room that the person can't see, and you have only one monetary instrument. Let's say it's a $100 bill, and you use your color copier, and you print out $100,000 based on $100 bill. And it doesn't have to even be a real dollar bill. You can just print it from a picture of a picture. And so you could print it from nothing. You just use your color copier to keep to print $100,000 from nothing. And then you give it to the guy, and he signs for it, and then he has to pay you back in interest. Now, the only thing it would cost you is the change cartridges, and, you know, the rent for the office. And you could make a fortune. But, of course, if you did that, it's called counterfeiting, and you would be arrested. Now, but that's how the entire monetary system works. The Federal Reserve is not printing money because they have giant warehouses of gold or banks stacked high with cash, and they loan you money based on the fact that they have a reserve of money, and then you got to pay them back for interest. They have nothing. You really need to understand this. They have absolutely nothing there. You break down the bank of the Federal Reserve. There's nothing in it. There's no gold. There's nothing. They're printing money from nothing, and they loan it to governments. Like America owes the Federal Reserve like $22 trillion. And then those other banks loan it to people like you and me for mortgages and car loans or whatever. Seconds on your house, and the nations are slaves to the Federal Reserve, and we are slaves to the banks, because in a heartbeat they'll take away your house, repossess your property if you don't pay it off. But they are legally allowed to print money from nothing and loan it to you. You see what a scam that is? It's a total scam, and that's why it's occultic. They're printing money from nothing. And most people can't grasp this for this reason. It's not because it's too complicated. It's because it's so simple that they can't possibly believe that anybody could be getting away with this. That's the stumbling block. When you tell this to the average person, and I've told this to the average person, and I've been on major cable news networks debating leading economists, first of all, on the major cable news networks, if you even come close to telling the truth about the Federal Reserve, they'll cut your mic and you won't be invited back. So the average person can't get it because it's so simplistic. Now, I was talking to one of the world's leading economists, Dr. Werner, a couple of weeks ago, and he is the economist above the economists at the Federal Reserve. And he works for one of the central banks in Europe. And he was in Japan in the 1990s when Japan was having its major economic crisis. And the central banks and the Federal Reserve were terrified that the Japanese economic crisis would go into a full-blown global economic meltdown. So Dr. Werner, who I had the privilege of talking to for a couple of hours, told me he came up with the concept of quantitative easing, where they would incrementally print money. He did not say money from nothing, but I directly asked him, do you mean printing money from nothing? And he gave me kind of a circular reasoning answer. But in any case, he talked about how it kept the global financial system from crashing. And then he said when the 2007 mortgage crisis hit the United States and was about to cause a full-blown global economic meltdown, the Federal Reserve and the head of the Federal Reserve, Alan Greenspan, they were panicking. They didn't know what to do. They didn't have a solution. They knew that the world was going to go into a massive economic meltdown. But Greenspan remembered what Dr. Werner had done in Japan, and he asked Dr. Werner to give the Federal Reserve a plan on how they could prevent a global economic meltdown. And so Dr. Werner came up with a plan of quantitative easing, a whole series of quantitative easing cycles, of which they printed money from nothing and kept an economic blowout from happening. But I asked Dr. Werner directly about printing money from nothing and the whole thing, and he was relatively transparent, certainly didn't disagree with me, because it's true. And he's the economist above the economists of the Federal Reserve. So this is the occultic economic system that runs our world. Thomas Jefferson knew about it. He warned America about it. And many people have known about it, but you're not allowed to talk about it publicly. So I talk about this in the book, A Prophecy of the Future of America, 2016, 2017, and the DVD sets, because I want everybody to understand all of the implications this has. And then, most importantly, how it is totally integrates with Bible prophecy, because once again, you can't understand Bible prophecy unless you understand the money system. And then three, I teach from God's Word in the book and DVDs principles that are supernatural that will enable God's people to be victorious and overcomers when it comes to economics, jobs, supply, income, retirement, and other things, because God does not want his people to be victims of a Luciferian Babylonian system. But knowledge is power. And Jesus Christ said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. But you can't be free in the realm of economics unless you understand the truth. So what we're dealing with is the system of Babylon, a one-world government, one-world religion, one-world economic system that reappears in Revelation 17, 18. And when it started in Babylon, and it was referred to in the New Testament in the book of Revelation as Mystery Babylon, it replicated itself. They just changed the name of the gods, and they changed the names of the outward names. So Pharaoh did the same thing with the Pharaoh God King system. And basically what they do is they convince the people that the elite, what Aldous Huxley called the scientific elite or the technocratic elite, they convince the people that the elite are like godlike, like Plato's 10 philosopher kings, or the kings of Europe were the divine right of kings, that they were genetically the descendants of the gods. So they create a religious system, an occultic religious system that convinces people that the elite are to be worshipped and served as gods. Therefore, it's perfectly acceptable for you to be a slave on their global plantation because, after all, they're genetically superior, they're godlike. That must be your cosmic destiny. And it's kind of a brainwashing system, an occultic brainwashing system, which entails the one world economic system. Now, this interfaces with the religious system, with the economic system, and the governmental system. So let me play it out. The Bilderberg Group in 2008 talked about the necessity of a microchip implant at every meeting that they've had, including the most recent meeting in Dresden, Germany. They have high-level people from the tech industry and the computer industry, and they want a cashless society implemented very quickly, and they want to implement a microchip implant, and they have many reasons for this. Now, notice how in the book of Revelation, God talks about a microchip implant nanochip implant, biochip implant, the mark of the beast, 666, and how you can't buy or sell or participate in the global economic system unless you have this mark of the beast. But notice you have to first participate in the one world religious system to get into the one world economic system, which simply means you have to, at this time when this global Babylonian system reaches its pinnacle once again with the coming of Antichrist, the coming of the false prophet, described in Revelation 13, every person who's here on earth is told, if you want to participate in the economic system and get the mark of the beast, the microchip implant or whatever, you are going to have to. So every person is given the opportunity, but the requirement for getting the mark of the beast to be able to buy and sell in the one world economic system is that you have to renounce Jesus Christ as Lord, you have to deny Jesus Christ as Lord, and you have to pledge that you are going to worship the Antichrist as God. You see, there's a ticket, a big ticket price to get the mark of the beast. So yeah, you'll be allowed to participate in the global economic system, but you're going to have to renounce Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord and pledge to worship the Antichrist as God. It's only then, after you're willing to do that, that you will be given the mark of the beast, and it'll give you the ability to buy and sell, and probably contains all kinds of information. It'll have an RFID transmitter with a computer brain interface, and a computer brain interface that goes to a hive mind or a world brain, which will be like a collective consciousness, like a cloud system where all people's minds will be merged into one mind. And it gets very heavy. Now, then this, of course, is enforced through the one world government. So if you say, no, I am not going to worship the Antichrist as God, then the Bible specifically says they're going to use their army or police or governmental systems. You're going to be killed, and you will be killed. They will behead you. They will chop your head off. So that's the price tag for not accepting the mark of the beast when the Antichrist is ruling and reigning. Now, if you refuse, if you say, no, I'm not going to worship the Antichrist as God, and you refuse the mark of the beast, you will be beheaded and killed. Now, the other thing, though, is that when Christ returns after the 7-year tribulation period, and Christ returns and defeats the armies of the Antichrist and the false prophet at the Battle of Armageddon, and all the demonic powers and the Antichrist and Satan and the false prophet are sentenced into the abyss, every single person who chose to receive the mark of the beast will be sentenced into the lake of fire forever and ever. Their punishment is eternal damnation. So you see how the global economic, religious, and governmental system interface. That's how it interfaces. So now we're in the amping up period prior to it. So when we look at what's happening nationally and globally, we see other factors. So whatever nation you're listening to me in, and you're listening to me here on the Paul McGuire Talk, Paul McGuire Report on Blog Talk Radio, and you can pass the link on to your friends and get free videos, free information by going to paulmcguire.us. You can listen in and listen to the program as it broadcasts, or you can listen to the program later on, or you can listen to yesterday's program. Simply go to paulmcguire.us and you can go to the Blog Talk Radio, the Paul McGuire Report, and you can pass the link on to your friends. But the easiest way to do it is simply go to paulmcguire.us. Now, here's what I'm trying to communicate with the books and the DVDs and all this stuff. There's an acceleration of what's happening. There's a marked acceleration. And so most of the things, not all of them, but most of the things that we see in current events, and that's what I do, that's what I specialize in, why I've written 28 books on Bible prophecy and current events, and I speak at conferences. If you go to the PaulMcGuire.us website, there's a whole bunch of conferences I'm speaking at. I'm going back to Pikes Peak, speak at the Prophecy Watchers Conference. I'm speaking at Southwest Radio Conference. I'm speaking at so many conferences. They're all listed on my website, PaulMcGuire.us. You can find out about them. Plus, you can, if you can't come to the conference, you can get the live streaming for those conferences. Time is accelerating. So we see a number of things that are more than just current events. They're current events that are predicted in Bible prophecy. So we recently had the Brexit, or the British, at least for now, vote to exit the European Union. I personally don't think that's going to be a long-term thing. I think that's a short-term thing. European Union is predicted in Bible prophecy because the European Union is essentially the revived Roman Empire that Daniel the prophet saw when he interpreted a dream and vision of King Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon. And he predicted the four great world empires, starting with the Babylonian Empire and ending with the revived Roman Empire, which was viewed in the vision and dream as 10 toes mixed with clay. And it's talked about in Revelation as 10 kings. I personally believe that the revived Roman Empire will center around where the previous Roman Empire was, which is the general area of the European Union, and that it may also involve the 10 regional global governments, such as the North American Union, which has been talked about a great deal recently, which is supposed to be a mirror of the European Union. Now, and the North American Union has been going full blast, full speed ahead for the administration of Bush, and the NAFTA and the CAFTA agreements are all part of that North American Union thing. So the North American Union is a mirror arrangement to the European Union, and then you have the Asian Union and the African Union, and then the European Union. Now, the European Union, listen carefully, because if you understand this, then you can be proactive and victorious. If you don't understand it, you're going to be fooled. The European Union was planned for, and again, it's the revived Roman Empire of Bible prophecy. The European Union was the plan of Adolf Hitler, the Third Reich, the secret occult societies, people like Martin Bormann, who Adolf Hitler gave the massive fortune of Nazi gold to, because the Nazis planned to sneak their fortune of Nazi gold out of Germany before they lost the war. And I believe Adolf Hitler did not die in that bunker. I believe he was smuggled into another nation, as were many of the Nazi elite. And before that happened, they smuggled the Nazi fortune out. And they smuggled it through Wall Street and various Wall Street firms. And then through the Marshall Plan, it came back and was reinvested in Germany and other corporations throughout the world. But Hitler and his key people planned for a Fourth Reich. The reign of Adolf Hitler was called the Third Reich. But the Fourth Reich was to happen after the Third Reich ended. So the principal planners of the European Union were high-level Nazis, people like Prince Bernard of the Netherlands, who was a high up in the SS and supposedly following the orders of Adolf Hitler's right-hand man, Martin Bormann. And they planned at the Bilderberg meetings to create a European Union. So Nazi money, Nazi organizational planning, and Nazi ideas were behind the creation of the European Union, which was designed to be a Fourth Reich and a dictatorial superstate that would rule the world. And so that is launching full speed ahead. Now, it's a temporary thing that Britain is exiting. I believe that they're going to be strong-armed back into the European Union. And even though the European Union is having enormous problems financially and with migration, just the other day we had the head of Italy in the European Union saying that he would go against the European Union and begin printing money from nothing to pay off all the debts that Italy had, which annoys nations like Germany, which are financially solvent. So there's restlessness and infighting in the European Union. But Angela Merkel, whose background is, she's a high-level physicist, by the way. Germany is a very profitable, strong, rebuilding its military, and it is a very powerful force within the European Union. And reportedly, Germany has connections with the Vatican, and this could be the beginning of the revived Holy Roman Empire, which will become the fourth beast in Bible prophecy. And the fourth beast is this revived Roman Empire that will rule the world, and the Antichrist will rule the world from the revived Roman Empire, as Bible prophecy says. It is from the fourth beast you will have the mark of the beast, the microchip implant, which is being promoted through Bilderberg. And then the Antichrist will set himself up in the rebuilt temple of Jerusalem and demand that he's worshipped as God 3.5 years into the tribulation period. And from there we go into Armageddon and the second coming of Jesus Christ. So Bible prophecy is being fulfilled before our very eyes. But in the background, the elite heads, the secretive elite that rules the world behind the scenes, the royal families, the heads of these multinational corporations that pass on their wealth from generation to generation, many of them are in satanic, occultic, secret societies, and are deeply involved in the occult. They're not worshipers of Jesus Christ. And they have made pacts, if you will, with the Lucifer and perform Luciferian rituals. This is this architecture of evil that I refer to, and that if you're ignorant of it, it's going to blindside you because it's happening. It's a fulfillment of Bible prophecy. They are together setting the stage for the global government, the global economic system, and the global religion. And they are Luciferians, and we see manifestations of this everywhere. So, for example, the CERN Hadron Collider. I was watching the YouTube the other day of this openly hardcore satanic ritual performed in the Gothard Tunnel, which is relatively near one of the vicinities of where the collider is. And it's a hardcore satanic ritual out in the open, performed before the whole world. And one of the purposes, according to the the former head of the CERN Collider Project. One of the purposes of the Collider is to crack open the door into other dimensions and allow entities from another dimension to come into the Earth. Now, they say entities, but the Bible would not designate these things as entities coming in from other dimensions. The Bible would say they're fallen angels. Now, if we go back into time, and this I talk about in my other book, A Prophecy of the Future of America, which is distinct from an entirely different book, A Prophecy of the Future of America 2016-2017, and the Babylon Code, the Tower of Babel was an astrological worship tower from which the mystery Babylons originated. Nimrod was its leader, and it was a human attempt to have the people elevate themselves physically towards the throne room of God and to worship the host of heaven. So they worshiped a religion of stars, symbols, and numerology. This is the same occult religion that's in place today. It's the religion of the worship of the stars, the occult, numerology, and symbols. That's why Christine Lagarde of the International Monetary Fund made a speech before prominent journalists and at the Council on Foreign Relations, where she devoted the majority of her speech talking about numerological symbols and the occult, and then the need for a global economic reboot or a global economic reset. What does that mean? Does that mean the elite are planning to wipe out, for example, the dollar, create a new cashless global currency, and go into a microchip implant? That's what it appeared she was alluding to. But you see, again, you see the elite, Christine Lagarde, involved in occult numerological religions. Now, the Nazis understood this, because when they were doing their research as far back as the 1920s, they were getting into the area of zero-point energy, unlimited free energy, the same thing Tesla was involved in. They were getting into areas which meant that you could pull unlimited amount of energy in from another dimension. Yet they understood that, and the reason they were pursuing this is because they wanted Germany in the war to be free from dependence of the other nations, to be free from dependence on the need for oil. So they wanted energy from another dimension. So these occultic sciences and economic systems are all part of the last days. And so I believe, as I wrote about in my books, I believe that the Tower of Babel was a interdimensional stargate that was created to allow entities from another dimension to enter the earth, or fallen angels to enter into the earth, which is what the CERN Hadron Collider is for, according to the words of the scientists and the former head of the CERN project. Now, the Tower of Babel was an interdimensional stargate that allowed entities from another dimension into the earth. And let's remember that prior to, before the building of the Tower of Babel, before the flood of Noah, the trigger event which caused the flood of Noah was the fact that the B'nai Elohim, which means the sons of God, were mating with human women and producing an interspecies breeding of a race called the Nephilim, which were genetically part human, part fallen angel, which was disgusting to God. It was a perversion of God's DNA. Man was created in the image of God. That's what it says in Genesis. Man was created in the image of God. And so now fallen angels are violating the law of God and mixing their DNA with human women. That is a pollution and a defilement that is hideous to God, because man, who's supposed to be created in the image of God, has now perverted himself on the genetic level and has merged his DNA with fallen angels who follow Lucifer. That's repugnant to God. So I believe that was the primary reason God flooded the earth, because God is not into punishing animals. And so the flood of Noah, that's why the flood of Noah wiped out all the animals, every human being, because the fallen angels were experimenting genetically, because they needed a host body. Demons need a host body. Jesus cast the demons out, and they always cried out to him to go into a bay of pigs or whatever. Demons can't operate fully without a physical body. So when God sent the flood of Noah, that flood of Noah was a targeted DNA genetic holographic judgment against the corrupted animal species by the fallen angels, and the who knows how many millions of people whose DNA was corrupted with fallen angel DNA. So the flood of Noah wiped all this out, and then that's why God said, bring two by two, male and female, of all the animals onto the ark. And Noah and his sons and their wives came onto the ark. And then when the flood subsided, God told them, be fruitful and multiply and subdue the earth and replenish it. Started all over again, which happened. But also, through apparently one of the descendants of Noah's wives, she had relations with a fallen angel, and the human race and the DNA was corrupted once again. Now, this is why it's not accidental that in our time Jesus Christ said, as it was in the days of Noah, so it will be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. That's not just a happen chance statement that Jesus Christ made. He's saying that in our time, there's going to be a resurgence of the Nephilim. There's going to be a resurgence of interspecies breeding. And if you look at it scientifically, we have all kinds of secret laboratories now where they are breeding the DNA of man and animal in the creation of super soldiers, because animals have characteristics like super strength, the need for less sleep, hibernation, night vision, and by genetically breeding some of these animal characteristics into human beings, they can create a super soldier. But that is forbidden by God, by the way, because it's the mixing of animal DNA with human DNA, which is forbidden by God. It's forbidden in the book of Leviticus. But on top of that, many people believe that there is Nephilim DNA here on the earth. Perhaps bodies have been discovered frozen in caves which contain intact DNA from fallen angels or the Nephilim. Many people have speculated that some of the mummies, that the remains of the mummies were preserved so well that if you would unwrap their burial cloths, you might be able to find intact DNA. And so theoretically, it's purely theoretical and speculative. Theoretically, you could take one of the pharaoh's ancient DNA cells and use it to recreate a man with a modern man's DNA. And it was thought that the ancient pharaohs had already crossbred with the fallen angels anyway. And so they believe that fallen angel DNA has been discovered and is being secretly used in laboratories to create an interspecies breeding that consists of animal, human, and Nephilim DNA. In any case, the science of transhumanism, which was essentially non-existent 20 years ago, is now one of the major powerhouse sciences, along with biotechnology, genetic engineering. And you go back to the Third Reich, again, created by occult secret societies. The Third Reich was a genetic dictatorship, a DNA dictatorship, because one of the primary missions of the Third Reich was to create a super race of Ubermensch, supermen, a master race. And the way they planned to do that is they incorporated sciences discovered by Rockefeller in the 1920s in laboratories in Cold Spring, New York, where eugenics was being performed. They were selectively breeding to create an advanced, a superior race. So the Third Reich, the plan was to exterminate everyone who Hitler and the Third Reich thought had inferior DNA, and that was people who were mentally retarded, sickness, disease, gypsies, and Jews. This was Hitler's belief system. And they were killed, along with Protestants, horribly in the Holocaust. They annihilated 7 million people. And then they had the Lettersborn program, where they found what they believed were young men and women, blonde-haired, blue-eyed, or fit the genetic characteristics of a master race. They had them breed and multiply. This was called the Lettersborn program. And so one of the games of the Third Reich, an occult regime, was to create, through the science of eugenics, a master race, which is really the goal of transhumanism, is to create artificial immortality and a master race. So when we hear the words of Jesus Christ, as it was in the days of Noah, so it will be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man, doesn't appear to be all that far-fetched, does it? No, it doesn't. It's Bible prophecy coming alive, because much of what we're talking about was unthinkable a number of years ago. Now it's commonplace. And notice that throughout all of this, there is this occultic, Luciferian, satanic themes. Occult worship, Satanism, as a fellow traveler with science and technology. It's eerie and it's disturbing, but it is a manifestation of Bible prophecy on an economic level, a scientific level, a religious level, a governmental level. And let's take it further than that. And by the way, if you're just tuned in, you're listening to the Paul McGuire Report on Blog Talk Radio, and you can send your friends a link of this program by simply going to the website paulmcguire.us, and you can send them a link to the program and free articles and DVDs and YouTubes. And we also post the show in YouTube form, and you can link to that at paulmcguire.us. Now, regarding the information I've talked about, we have several books that deal with this, which you should get so you can get up to speed. And that is A Prophecy of the Future of America 2016-2017, along with the 4-DVD set. You can get that at paulmcguire.us. You can get intensive information on the Third Reich and the occult and all that with the book A Prophecy of the Future of America, which is entirely different than the book A Prophecy of the Future of America 2016-2017. And another book I want to mention, which I believe is absolutely essential and one of the primary reasons that I do this radio show, which is being heard all around the world. I have a book out called Mass Awakening. And the basic message of the book Mass Awakening, and everyone should read it and utilize it. The message of Mass Awakening is that we are about ready to undergo a mass awakening of satanic, demonic, evil forces. And this will be precipitated or activated by an economic crisis, a political crisis, or something which generates a mass awakening that is evil and destructive and satanic, in the same way that Adolf Hitler and the Third Reich generated a mass awakening, which was evil, destructive, and satanic, with the Nazis. In the same way, ISIS is a movement that is evil, satanic, and destructive. It's a mass awakening that is demonic. Now, in the book Mass Awakening, I say this is going to happen. And in fact, it is happening. But I go into a territory in Mass Awakening that most people don't explore, and that is that it is not God's will that a demonic, satanic mass awakening arise and destroy millions of people's lives. That's not the will of God. And so God gives us an opportunity. God steps into human history right now. He steps into where you and I live now. He steps into whatever nation you're listening to me in through you. God steps into your life, and through your life, God steps into human history. And God, because God's love for us, see, God loves us both eternally, and God loves us in the present tense. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's God's offer, that if you believe on him as Savior, he will save you, he will make you born again, and you will live forever with him in eternity. That's an eternal offer. But God also offers to step into this temporary physical dimension and step into our history and offer his supernatural help, his supernatural protection through the power of his Holy Spirit. And many Christians neglect this because they have a faulty view of what Bible prophecy is teaching. They suffer from the spiritual deception and poorly taught prophecy Bible teaching, which says something like this: it's the last days, evildoers are growing worse and worse, there's nothing we can do about anything except wait for Jesus Christ to return, and we just kind of hang in till then. And that is not what the Bible teaches anywhere in the Word of God. In fact, it teaches the opposite. And so, because many Christians, millions of them, and this is really is the doctrine of devils, because many Christians embrace this faulty view of Bible prophecy, they're not open to the desire of God to step into their lives, to step into human history right now, and stop the satanic mass awakening, and stop the forces of evil, and instead send the supernatural power of revival upon his church and pour out the power of the Holy Spirit on his church, so that when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against him. You see, God wants to launch a peaceful, law-abiding, spiritual counterattack against the forces of hell and drive them back. But it requires his church to be open to it, to believe him for it. And you can't believe him for it if you're simultaneously believing that God will do nothing but passively watch your world, your nation, being destroyed, which is embracing a spiritual era. So I wrote Mass Awakening to drive home the point from Scripture that even though this satanic mass awakening is occurring, that it is the desire of God to intrude into our lives, intrude into our nations and our communities, to intrude in our history right now with the power of His Holy Spirit and raise up a church in revival, a supernatural church in revival, a supernatural church clothed with power from on high, to ignite His people, the church, with a biblical revival and a biblical third great awakening, and drive back the powers of darkness and defeat the works of darkness and cause us to be overcomers and take back the land. And that will happen. That's a mass awakening that's godly. So the thesis of the book is you can have a satanic mass awakening, but if you have a biblical third great awakening, you have a God-inspired mass awakening that leads to good. Now, people have a stronghold about that. And a stronghold is a satanically energized argument erected by Satan in their minds that's built on lies that blocks them from being set free of the truth of God's word. Because Jesus Christ said, "You shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free." So if the devil can convince millions of Christians that all you do is you're passive and you wait for Christ to return, then the devil is free to go about like a roaring lion seeking whom he may destroy, which is not the will of God. So that I explain that and teach that in Mass Awakening. And I want you to get that book as well as the others, because I want you to participate with me in planting the seeds of revival, in planting the seeds of a third great awakening and a biblical revival in your nation and your community so that you can take back your land for Jesus Christ. But you see, you can't do that unless you have a biblical argument that is capable of destroying the strongholds of the adversary. As long as people's minds are held in captivity by the lies of Satan masquerading as biblical truth, all hell's going to break loose, and not in a good way. So let's address something right here front and center. And again, you can get all this information and send the links to the program and watch the YouTube at paulmcguire.us, and McGuire's McGuire. And this is the mission that the Lord has called me to by the power of His Holy Spirit, not only to spread the fires of revival, to preach the gospel, and to win souls for Jesus Christ, and through this program, many, many people receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and many, many people who are backslidden come back to Jesus Christ, because what they hear in this program, the Paul McGuire Report, is not a religious Christian message. They hear a relevant, truthful, biblical message, but it's something that they're open to. And the truth that they hear in it sets them free, and they end up getting saved, or they end up repenting of their backsliding and coming back to Jesus Christ as Lord. So you need to send the fires of those revivals, fire of that revival, the fire of that salvation, into your area. See, I need you to partner with me in doing this. I can't do it alone. There are many people partnering with me around the world. I need you to partner with me with your prayers, your gifts, your donations, and then use the resources, or even the free resources. Use the resources. Have people come over for coffee. Have them discuss. Because listen, man, there's a reason why in your nation, city, state, or whatever, the Christians are all, they all seem like they're asleep. There's a reason for that. Or they're all in a state of paralysis. Or worse yet, you meet all these Christians that they're like in a trance state. There's a reason for that. And you know what that reason is? They're deceived spiritually. And so you and I have to partner together so that the power of the Holy Spirit, like a flash of lightning, can unblind their eyes and they can see. You see, when the Spirit of God touches somebody with the truth, Remember how when the truth of salvation came alive to you and you wanted to accept Christ and you were born again, and all of a sudden you realized, wow, there is a God. I was a sinner. I did need to be saved. You had this revelation, and it transformed your lives. In the same way, the people that we're trying to reach, the people that I'm asking you to join with me in partnership to reach, they have not heard the truth yet in a way that has caused that aha moment where they say, oh my God, there, Jesus is Lord. I am a sinner. I do need to invite Christ in my life as my Lord and Savior. I do need to be born again. Or, oh, dear God, I was wrong about this. I was like in a trance state. I was asleep. And you look at the Christians around you, and they're all walking around like robots. That's not the way God intended it to be. Do you understand me? God never intended. He created you before the beginning of time, for such a time as this. He did not create you to walk around like a robot in a trance state. That is a deception of the devil. And yet you have churches embracing it. They're not embracing it like they're aware of they're embracing it, but then that result is they're embracing it. And we need to partner together to set them free, or we're going to lose our nation. And there's nothing romantic. You have all these people taking the Bible out of the context. And man, it breaks my heart. I hear it all the time. The Word of God says, my people perish for lack of knowledge. My people perish for lack of knowledge. It's not God's desire for his people to perish for lack of knowledge. Please hear me. It is not the will of God for his people to perish for lack of knowledge. But when you convince people, I know, you know, many Bible teachers and stuff, and they romanticize persecution. And they say things like, well, you know, we need persecution. It will purify the church. And so they don't do anything. They don't tell their people to vote or to pray or to get involved, because they're welcoming persecution. Because they say from their own mouths, well, persecution will purify the church. Well, the problem with that statement is it's partially true, but mostly a lie. See, all, and I'm not accusing the people of lying, I just think they're deceived. When you mix this, any good deception or any good lie, in order for it to be palatable, has to contain a certain amount of truth. So a certain amount of truth in it. The truth is that, yes, when persecution comes, it's going to strip away all the props that the church has been relying on. It's going to force us to set aside our petty differences. It's going to force us to our knees in pray. It will force us to experience revival, because we're going to be suffering under persecution. And that will purify the church. There's a partial truth there. But it's not the main truth. And it's not the primary biblical truth that God wants. Now, let me break that down for you really simply. We are cleansed or purified from our sins totally by the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ on the cross. Hear me, please. Our sins are purified. They are taken away. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from sin when we put our faith in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So it is Jesus Christ alone who is the Lamb of God that takes away our sins. It's not of works, lest any man should boast. That is the most important truth in the Bible. So to suggest an add-on where you say, well, persecution will purify the church, what you're saying is that The death and resurrection of the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ on the cross, wasn't sufficient. That you got to add persecution to it. That's works, man. That's legalism. What you're doing is you're saying by going through persecution, which is a form of legalism or works, you're going to be purified. There's no difference in teaching that than saying if you say five Hail Marys and four Our Fathers that you'll be forgiven of your sins. Those are works. Or that if you go around and do a lot of good works, feeding the hungry, clothing the poor, that you'll be forgiven of your sins. It's not that God doesn't want you to do those things, but that does not cleanse you from sin. Those are works. The only thing, listen to me, it's the entire centrality of the biblical message. The only thing, this exclusive, totally only thing that cleanses you from your sin is believing on Jesus Christ and accepting his finished work on the cross. That is what cleanses you or purifies you from sin, period. To do an end run around that and suggest, well, persecution will purify the church, is a deception. Because it implies that works have to be added, that the blood of Jesus Christ was not enough. Now, that is a very, very serious spiritual error, by the way. And it's wrong biblically, as I just explained. Now, so we need to repent of that faulty belief system, because it's embracing the doctrine of works or legalism. It's called another gospel that Paul warned of. The another gospel was a gospel based on works. Persecution does not get you into heaven. Salvation by faith in Christ gets you into heaven. And then finally, they romanticize persecution as somehow it's a liberating, joyous experience. You know, the only people I have ever heard who romanticize persecution are those people who have never gone through it themselves, and they sit in their air-conditioned sanctuaries, studying the scripture from the comfort of their living rooms, never having experienced persecution firsthand, and make these ridiculous pronouncements about how persecution is going to be good for the church. Whereas every Christian that I've talked to that have come from former communist countries or some of the European nations that became communistic or escaped from Cuba or other communist nations, they all said the same thing. Persecution is total hell. It's a total nightmare. And I'm going to do everything I can now that I'm in America to fight to see that kind of thing doesn't happen here. I have never met one person coming from a nation where they experienced severe persecution who ever said that they were going to pray that same persecution would come to America. Every single person that I talked to, without exception, that experienced persecution wanted to do everything that they possibly could to wake up the American church so that persecution would not have to come here. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Are you hearing what I'm saying? Ideas have consequences, and bad ideas can have deadly consequences. We are to guard ourselves from spiritual error. That's part of putting on the full armor of God. If we embrace the error, no matter where you live in the world, wherever you're listening to me, if you embrace the lie, and that's what it is, if you embrace the deception, and that's what it is, that persecution is going to purify you, then you are going to suffer the most awful evil on earth that God never wanted you to suffer, because you embraced a lie and you did not bother to rightly divide the word of God. Now, I've just told you the truth based on scripture. The argument I presented is irrefutable. You cannot argue against what I just explained biblically. You can't refute it. It's impossible, because I'm saying one thing. You're saved by faith in Christ and faith in Christ alone. If you add works to it, which is what that is, you're in deception. But nobody who knows how to rightly divide the word of God would disagree with me. So you need to protect yourself from that kind of thinking. You need to be on guard when you hear preachers preach like that or Christians blab on about that. You need to lovingly challenge it and not let it stand, because it's a contamination. It will spread, and it invites a doorway. It opens a doorway for the devil to come kill, steal, and destroy. So let's pray that that doesn't happen, because it's not a good thing. It's not what God wants. This is not what God wants. So that's right, why I wrote Mass Awakening, so that we could pray to the Lord and have a biblical revival and a third great awakening. I talked to you about this Luciferian satanic revival sweeping around the world. Why is it happening? It's happening because there's a void, there's a vacuum in the nations of the earth. You see, if you have a dead, unbelieving church, which is what most of the church, not all of it, but it's what most of the church has become around the world. It's become rather dead, complacent, kind of like the Laodicean church in the book of Revelation, which is neither hot nor cold, but lukewarm. That Jesus said, because you're neither hot nor cold, but lukewarm, I'm going to vomit you out of my mouth. That's the condition of most of the church. If you ask yourself the question in America, why Wicca, which is witchcraft, is the fastest growing religion, I will tell you the reason for that is that most evangelical churches no longer believe and teach the Bible. The seminaries are filled with professors that tell pastors the Bible is not true, or it's an allegory, or it's a mythology. It is impossible to have revival and a strong church when you're indoctrinating and teaching Christian leaders and individual Christians that their Bible is not true. It's not reliable. That is weakening the faith. Two things have to happen. There has to be a repentance from that, and there must be a cleansing from that. That means in love, you have to have the assembly of Bible-believing Christians who sit, without getting into excessive legalism, at the same time speaking the truth in love, without getting off into a tangent of wild judgmentalism. But when they see Christian leaders and professors teaching messages which undermine the authority of Scripture, it has to be confronted and challenged. And then there has to be spiritual discipline. If you're going to teach in a seminary and say that, well, maybe the story of the Red Sea opening up was a metaphor, you have to be asked to leave the seminary. There has to be a cleansing. You understand? So you have a vital role to play in this. I have a vital role to play. We are in the last days, and the powers of darkness are accelerating and growing. So what's the solution for you and I as individual Christians? Well, I laid out part of it. But then let's go back to the book of Acts and look at what caused 12 ordinary men, fishermen, tax collector, so on and so forth, what caused these 12 ordinary men to be so filled with the power of the Holy Spirit that they were able to go into all the world and preach the gospel and to make disciples themselves. And Christianity in its early days was so powerful, so forceful, that it literally conquered the most powerful empire on the face of the earth at the time, which was the Roman Empire. What was it? Well, when we look at the book of Acts, they met in the upper room. They were of one mind, one accord. They were worshiping the Lord. And then the Lord poured out his Holy Spirit upon them, and they were clothed with power from on high. The dunamis, dynamite. They were clothed with power from on high, and they were then supernaturally enabled to do what they could never have done in their own human strength. They could preach the gospel like Jesus preached it. It was followed with signs and wonders. They had authority in their voice. The power of God moved through them. The anointing of the Holy Spirit attended their messages. People got saved. The church grew exponentially. There was revival. The church was alive. So the question is asked, how do we conduct ourselves where we are in terms of the last days? Well, we do what the early church did. We repent of our sins. We repent of our unbelief. And when we repent of our sins and repent of our unbelief, God sends his power upon us, and we can drive back the forces of evil, and people can be saved. On July 4th, 2012, I was sitting in our office talking with my wife. We were reminiscing about our dating years on July 4th, many years ago in Manhattan, New York, when there was the celebration of the bicentennial, and ships from all around the world were sailing around New York, and it was very beautiful. And my wife and I were reminiscing about that because we were dating on July 4th. And then it was July 4th, 2012, as we were reminiscing. And after we reminisced, I felt that, you know, I felt like going to the Lord in prayer. And I went before the Lord in prayer, bowed my head at my desk, and I asked God to personally forgive me of my sins. And then I asked God as an intercessor to forgive the Church of Jesus Christ of its sins. And I mentioned things like rejecting his word, not believing his word, and various things. So I, as an intercessor, I repented of the sins of the church. Now, this was on July 4th, 2012. And then something happened to me, and I don't use the word vision carelessly. I'm using it very precisely. But what happened on July 4th, 2012 was after I repented of the sins of the church, my body was set on fire with the most intense heat that I have ever experienced in my entire life. I've been around the move of God for years. I've experienced many supernatural things. But the level and the intensity of the heat of the Holy Spirit literally caused my body to burn. In fact, my body was burning with such an intensity and heat that I was looking at my fingers to see if they were going to be harmed. And I tried to be as methodical and calm as I shared this to my wife. I said, I'm burning. I said, I'm burning, you know, with the most intense heat. I can't understand why I'm not being harmed. And then I felt this divine flow come down from heaven and fill my body. And I said to my wife, I've just been healed of something. I said, I've been healed. But I really didn't know, and I don't know to this day what I was healed of, but I just knew that I was healed. And I could feel this flow of God's divine virtue flow through my body. Then the next thing I knew, I was looking down on the North American continent from the perspective of outer space, and I saw America kind of in the darkness. And then as I looked down on the West Coast where California was, I saw these lights begin to burst forth. And what I noticed was a biblical revival had broken out, and I saw people starting to rise in prayer. And as they started to rise in prayer, the glory of the Lord illuminated them. And so this glory of the Lord began to very slowly move from the West Coast to the East Coast. And at first I would see all these millions of darkened figures in the shadows, but as they started to rise, rising in prayer, they were illuminated with the glory of God. And so I saw millions of people lit up with the glory of God. And I heard the Lord say to me, they're starting to rise, they're rising in prayer. And so these millions of people began spreading from the West Coast to the East Coast, to the north and south of America, and they were rising in prayer. And what I knew as I was looking down on the North American continent, I knew I was seeing a third great awakening. And then this awakening spread to Europe and other continents in the world, and it just kept spreading. And then the next thing I knew, I was sitting back in my chair, and I opened my eyes, and as I thought about what I just experienced, I realized that what caused this thing, this biblical revival, this third great awakening to occur was one thing. It was very, very clear. It was predicated on personal repentance, and then the church collectively repenting of its sins before God, and not fake repentance, not playing church repentance, true repentance. And what the Lord told me, not in an audible voice, but what he told me is, if my people truly repent and seek my face, the Lord said, I will send a biblical revival and a third great awakening. And that, and then he says, I want you to tell this message around the world. And that was July 4th, 2012. And so it was simply a confirmation of what the Lord had been talking to me about through my books and writing and so on and so forth. And so now I devote my time speaking and writing and teaching on different subjects, but this is the heartbeat of my message. It's the central thrust of my message. You see, Jesus Christ said, we're to occupy until he comes. And that means the Church of Jesus Christ is to occupy the land that God has given it until he comes. And occupation means maintaining the authority of Christ over it, not giving it over to the devil. And Jesus Christ also said that we're to do business until he comes. And so that means that God expects us to do his kingdom business. And that means saving souls, but it means also building things, creating things, and that requires money and finances. And that's why I devoted such a large part of the book, A Prophecy of the Future of America, 2016-2017, teaching God's people how to view God as their source, capital S, and how to receive supernatural wisdom, supernatural guidance, supernatural favor, supernatural financing, if you will, as God as their source, because God's people are not supposed to be victimized by an occult world system designed to enslave them. Jesus Christ came to set God's people free, and that means not only spiritually and emotionally and psychologically, but God wants to supernaturally set his people free financially. God doesn't want his people in this mentality that we're supposed to hide out somewhere. You know, businesses can be birthed. Ministries can be birthed. Outreaches can be birthed. The dreams can be materialized in the last days. And that requires finances and God's guidance. But it requires an understanding of economics and money that is superior. See, God has a kingdom of economic principles that is supernatural and superior to the occult system, but God's people need to know how to use that. So that's the burden that the Lord put on my heart, to teach these things. Because right now, the people of the Lord all over the world right now, they're somewhat fearful and dismayed. They're looking at the signs of the times as if their only job was to look at the signs of the times. And God never called his people to be spectators watching the end times unfold from a seat in a stadium or a movie theater. God called us to be participants with him in the end times. We're supposed to be partnering with God in his end times program. And that means we need to know how to walk in the power of the Spirit. We need to know how to understand the Word of God. So we need to be clothed with power from on high, the dunamis. But then we need to renew our minds with the Word of God. We need to guard ourselves from spiritual deception. But we really need to know what the Word of God is saying, not just assume somebody's interpretation is correct. We need to know for ourselves what the Word of God is saying. And there's a lot of Christians that I meet and talk to. They're bound. They read the Bible, but the Bible isn't setting them free. It's putting them in bondage because they're not listening to people teach the word that are teaching it, rightly dividing the word of God, which sets people free. They're listening to teachers that sneak in legalism or the doctrine of demons or works or some kind of system that poisons them and enslaves them. And that isn't good Bible teaching. Good Bible teaching is Jesus Christ said, you shall know the truth and the truth sets you free. And if I could, and by the way, I have, again, free information and videos and everything else, and you can send the link of this program, the Paul McGuire Report. You can access the program at paulmcguire.us. You can send the link to your friends anywhere in the world at paulmcguire.us, and you can watch the YouTube posting of this radio program at paulmcguire.us, which is on every Monday through Friday. Now, also, I'm speaking at a whole bunch of conferences. You can see the conference schedule at paulmcguire.us. So, you know, in summary, God is love. And if we need to remember anything, we need to remember God is love. Yes, God is righteous. Yes, God is just. We understand that. I'm not minimizing that. But God is love. So whenever God uses his justice, we can become very legalistic as Christians and mean-spirited. And that we don't win people to Christ being legalistic and mean-spirited. And often that's done with a zeal which is born out of being born out of a concern of not being, you know, too sloppy with grace and not there's the sincere desire of wanting to stand up for God's holiness and righteousness, but it's often communicated as being angry and mean-spirited. We're supposed to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves, so we can communicate God's holiness and the fact that God is a judge and that, you know, God is serious about what he says. We can communicate that, but we can communicate that with wisdom and love. And it's far more forceful, by the way, when it's communicated with wisdom and love. That doesn't mean we're diminishing God's holiness. Far from it. Bible prophecy teaches all about God's holiness. I don't diminish God's holiness for a moment. Nor do I diminish the reality of hell and judgment and the great white throne of judgment and the penalty eternally for rejecting Jesus Christ. I don't diminish that at all. But it has to be communicated, speaking the truth in love, and it has to be communicated with a deep concern regarding the person that you're talking to. You know, you can glibly say the cliche, you know, we're to hate the sin and love the sinner, but inwardly you're hating the sinner, and they pick it up. That doesn't win people to Jesus Christ. You have to have the agape love of Jesus Christ shed abroad in your heart so that when you look at somebody, your concern is the heartbeat of God, that they would accept Christ and live forever in heaven. You see, if you're generating hatred and you justify it because you think you're standing for his righteousness and holiness, you have to be very careful about it because it's a very slippery slope. No, we're not trying to soften the holiness or righteousness of God, but we have to speak the truth in love. And the major premise is God is love. And believe me, I understand the overreaction because there are so many ministers that preach this watered down Christianity, which is devoid of any truth to it, and it's a marshmallowy kind of mushy nothing. So people react to it, but sometimes by reacting to it, we go into the other extreme, and we miss the target, and we end up communicating in anger and lack of love. So the challenge is, and this challenge can only be accepted and done effectively by relying on the power of the Holy Spirit to move through us. And you see, to the degree that we allow the power of the Holy Spirit to flow through us as we minister, because you see, we can't minister apart from the power of the Holy Spirit flowing through us. We can't. If we're trying to minister in our own strength, it will always sound like a musical note off tune. To the degree we choose to worship the Lord and to walk in and to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, to the degree that we allow the Holy Spirit to flow through us to minister to others, to the degree that we renew our minds with the Word of God, that's to the degree we'll see fruitfulness. That's to the degree we'll see souls saved. That's to the degree we'll see hearts melt under the power of God. You know, you can bash somebody over the head with the Bible and blah, 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 blah. But let me tell you something. If you stand there in the anointing of the Holy Spirit, and the anointing of the Holy Spirit is flowing through you, and the life of the Spirit is ministering life to the person you're talking to, the very presence of God that's bathing that person as you speak and minister, the glory of God that fills that room that where you're talking, that changes the hardest of hearts. It literally causes hearts to melt. I have seen strong, tough men and hardened women who were in every respect totally resistant and hostile to the gospel of Jesus Christ. I have seen them when presented with the gospel, when you're ministering to them in the power of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is flowing through you. I have seen these people literally shake and tremble as if they were hit with an electrical force. I have seen them sob. I've seen their eyes well up with tears. I see them gasp a deep breath and sometimes break down sobbing in repentance, asking God to forgive them, asking God to save them. And that didn't happen through being harsh, and it didn't happen through trying to generate a forcefulness through human will or the forcefulness of our human personalities. It simply happened because we chose to walk in the power of the Holy Spirit and allow the power of the Holy Spirit to minister to people. It breaks the heavy burdens. It casts aside the strongholds. And see, to the degree that we do that in prayer and infuse our communities, our marriages, our families, our nation, our churches. And that doesn't mean backing off and allowing the truth of God's word to be hijacked by deception. That doesn't mean allowing the devil to turn the steering wheel and to drive the car off the course into false doctrine or New Age teachings. No, 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 no. You got to be strong about that. You got to guard yourself against that. You have to have a firm hand on the steering wheel. And you can't allow some demon to grab the steering wheel and crash the car off the side of the road into accepting a lie like always lead to heaven. That's a lie. You need to confront it as such. It's a lie. No, no, no. Jesus Christ, there's only one way to heaven. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but through me. You've got to be strong. You've got to be a leader like God has called you to do. The question is, You can be strong in the Spirit of the Lord and be a mighty man of God or a mighty woman of God. Or you can be wishy-washy in the flesh and basically fail in your mission. I'm Paul McGuire. Thank you for listening to me on the Paul McGuire Report. And it's a privilege to talk to you. This is, I have been talking for 4 hours now because the first 2 hours of the program, all the electricity crashed and dumped the entire audio file. So this 2 hours that you're listening to, I feel like I've been doing a marathon, but by God's grace, the Holy Spirit is with me. God bless you. I will catch you on tomorrow's program. Tune in to the Paul McGuire Report. Spread the link to your friends at paulmcguire.us. God bless you. And remember, Maranatha, Jesus is coming, and he's coming soon.